In this session, I'll be talking a bit about two conditions, that is sickle cell anemia and thalassemia. Though it is something which you will be learning more, you have learned more in medicine, in pathology, in different other conditions, I'll be again looking at it from a biochemical perspective, giving you the basics of sickle cell and thalassemia. Now, before we go further, let us look at the globin genes. Now, if you look at the globin genes, alpha gene is an alpha gene cluster is on the chromosome 16. There are two copies of alpha globin gene, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Beta globin gene is located on chromosome 11. There is a single copy of beta globin gene on chromosome 11. Now, remember, there are two chromosome 16s and two chromosome 11s. So, the total number of alpha genes will be alpha 1 of two chromosomes and beta of another two chromosomes. So alpha has 4 and beta has 2 locations on the chromosomes. So we come to what are called as hemoglobinopathies. Hemoglobinopathy, it is a disease in which the type of hemoglobin in a person's red blood cell differs either qualitatively or quantitatively from the hemoglobin that is usually contained in normal red cell. This is the definition. So I'll be looking at the qualitative one, and that is sickle cell anemia, and the quantitative one, that is thalassemia. They'll be just giving you the molecular basis of that. Now, first, sickle cell anemia. What is a sickle cell? Sickle cell is where the sickle, there is a sickle shaped red blood cell. Sickle shaped normal blood red blood cell, if you look at it, is concave, biconcave disc. Now, in sickle shell, they will have lost their biconcave shape and they will have become like a sickle, and these are called as sickle cells, sickle red blood cells. Now, the biochemical defect is glutamic acid in the sixth position of the beta chain is replaced by valine, and such a beta chain is represented as beta S. Now, the reason why it is replaced, again, we need the genetic basis for this. There is a point mutation of a single nucleotide of beta globin gene on chromosome 11. Remember, chromosome 11 has got the gene, beta globin gene region. In this, there is a point mutation. Thymine is replaced by adenine. A simple point mutation can lead to sickle cell disease. Now, genetic wise, sickle cell disease is an autosomal recessive disease. Therefore, the child can get sickle cell only and only if both the parents are carriers. And the chance, 25% of chance of getting it if both are carriers. It does not mean he will get it, 100% chance is there. It is just 25% chance if both the parents are carriers, otherwise it is not present. Now, sickle cell carrier, what is the thing? The mutation is in one copy of the hemoglobin beta chain. Remember, chromosome 11, two copies are there. So the mutation has happened in only one copy, not in the other copy. So what will happen? This type of thing is called as heterozygous state. Half of the beta subunits are replaced with the sickle celled beta, beta S. So this person is said to have the sickle celled trait. So if you look at a person who is a carrier, they will have 25% normal HBA, that is all 2 alpha, 2 beta. 50% will be in the form of HBS, that is 2 alpha, 1 beta S in the thing and 1 normal beta. And 25% will be in the form of HBSS, that is 2 alpha chains. Both the betas are the mutated beta chains, that is beta S and beta S. So even if he is a carrier, he will be having 25% HBSS, 50% HBS and 25% normal HBS. Now, what is a sickle cell disease? This results when both the copies of the hemoglobin beta chain have a mutation. Look at here. Both this chromosome 11 also has a mutation. This chromosome 11 also has a mutation. Thymine has replaced adenine in both of them, and that is when they are called as it can develop sickle cell disease. All of this person's beta subunits are replaced beta S. So his hemoglobin concentration 100% will be like this. 2 alpha, 2 beta S, 2 beta. Beta S will be the remaining. And he is said to be homozygous for this sickle cell disease. Now, I will be talking about why there is the sickling phenomenon. Now, whenever glutamate is replaced by valine, what will happen? This results in the formation of a sticky patch. This replacement of an amino acid results in the formation of a sticky patch on the deoxy hemoglobin. When the HbS is in the deoxy state, it results in the formation of a sticky patch. So if I show the hemoglobin like this, now whenever it is HbS is present, what will happen is it will result in the formation of a sticky patch. So what will happen is all this will result in the formation of a sticky patch. So whenever there is a sticky patch like this, these hemoglobin molecules will start polymerizing. This hemoglobin molecules will start polymerizing. So they will start polymerizing, and it will result in all these hemoglobin molecules will result in the formation of a hemoglobin aggregate. All the hemoglobins will form a hemoglobin aggregate. They will stick to each other and they will form a hemoglobin aggregate. So during deoxygenation, the HbS molecules aggregate at the sticky patches to form long fibers. The long fibers are formed. This process, so whenever hemoglobin should be normally distributed in a RBC, but when it forms a long fiber like this hemoglobin, what will happen? It will distort the shape of RBC. It cannot distribute completely in this, so it will result in the formation of the sickle cell. This sickle cell is because of formation of long fibrils of polymerized hemoglobin HbS molecules. What will happen if this is there? So what will happen is, now in the normal blood capillaries, RBCs can flow easily. RBCs keep on flowing everywhere. Wherever they want, they can flow. But suppose there is a sickle cell and there is a narrow capillary. Suppose there is a sickle cell and a very narrow capillary. This sickle cell can go and block this narrow capillaries. When it blocks, what will happen? If it was crescent shaped, biconcave shaped, it could have flown easily. But because it is not having a biconcave shape, in the narrow capillaries, it can go and block it. So it will obstruct the oxygen to this tissue, to whichever capillary is supplying to whichever tissue. This tissue will have lesser oxygen. So it causes tissue hypoxia, eventually cell death in the vicinity, leading to pain and crisis. Sickle cells have difficulty in squeezing through small capillaries. As a consequence, fragile sickle cells also rupture, leading to hemolytic anemia. Now, the symptoms could be anything like abdominal bone, joint pain, headaches, breathlessness, delayed growth, puberty, fatigue, anemia, jaundice, greater risk for infection, ulcers, chest pain, etc. Now, what increases the sickling phenomenon is increased by decreased oxygen tension. Why? Where example, like in high altitudes. Why? It is only in the deoxy state. It is in the deoxy state that polymerization takes place. So when is deoxy state more common? Whenever there is decreased oxygen tension. And one more is increased carbon dioxide concentration. Again, the deoxy state is more common. Whenever pH decreases, increased 2-3 BPG in RBCs, again the sickling phenomenon is increased. Now, in sickle cell trait do not show any clinical symptoms and usually have a normal lifespan, but they have one feature: they are less susceptible to falciparum malaria. The malarial parasite has a part of its life cycle within the RBCs. So lysis of RBC interrupts the life cycle, and this is actually a genetic reason which is beneficial to the society, and that is why it has happened. I'll talk a bit more on the investigations of sickle cell anemia. How do we diagnose? There are different tests. One is the sickling test, the solubility test, hemoglobin electrophoresis, prenatal diagnosis, and amino acid sequencing. So which is, out of all this, the solubility test is the easiest to be done. Very quick identification of HbS. The procedure is the blood sample is treated with a reducing substance. Why? We want it to be converted to deoxy state, like sodium sulfate. All hemoglobin molecules molecules get deoxygenated. HBS is insoluble, it results in the formation of a turbidity. If turbidity appears, it presence of HBS is confirmed. However, there are drawbacks. We cannot quantitate how many HBS is present, how much of HBS, and thereby we cannot differentiate the trait from the disease. Remember, the trait also has certain amount of HBS. Hemoglobin electrophoresis is more preferred. It is at alkaline pH on cellulose acetate paper it is taking place. HBS disease, all hemoglobin is in HBS form. In sickle cell trait, both HbA and HBS are seen. And during electrophoresis, HbA moves fastest towards the anode. HBS moves slower towards anode due to the fewer negative charges. Remember, glutamate, a charged amino acid, has been replaced by valine, which is uncharged amino acid. So if you look at it, in normal patient, you will have only HbA moving faster to the anode. In the sickle cell trait, you will have some amount of HbA and some amount of HbS. Whereas in sickle cell anemia, you will have HbS which moves slower than HbA. This is somewhat a cellulose acetate. That is how they will look like. Prenatal diagnosis of sickle cell disease also can be done by RFLP, what we call restriction fragment length polymorphism analysis of the fetal DNA. And this is obtained from amniotic fluid or by the chorionic villi by amniocentesis. Fetal DNA is cut into fragments by restriction enzyme. The fragments are separated by electrophoresis. Difference in the length of fragments is measured. So that we can come to know it. Now another hemoglobinopathy is HBC disease. Again here it is a point mutation. Glutamate in the sixth position is substituted by lysine. In electrophoresis, HBC moves slower than HbS and leads to mild chronic hemolytic anemia. We'll go further with the thalassemias. Thalassemias are hereditary disorders that can result in moderate to severe anemias. The basic production, as I said, sickle cell is a qualitative hemoglobinopathy, whereas thalassemia is a quantitative. So there must be some quantity involved. So either the hemoglobin chains are decreased or increased. So it is reduced production of selected globin chain. If alpha chain is reduced, you call it alpha thalassemia. If beta chain is reduced, you call it beta thalassemia. It is as simple as that. Now, what are the genetic defects? One reason could be frame shift mutations, gene deletions or substitution. It could be because of unstable mRNA, defect in the initiation of protein synthesis or premature chain termination. So go ahead with alpha thalassemia. Now genetics about that. Remember, each chromosome 16 carries 2 genes for alpha chain. Therefore, total in an individual is 4 genes. So it can be alpha, 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 alpha. We write it like this. Now I put a division here between genes inherited from both the parents. Dash means there is gene deletion. So if you look at alpha thalassemia, normal is alpha, alpha, alpha. Silent carrier is one gene deletion from one side, or trait or minor could be 2 genes have been deleted, or either from the same chromosome or from the different chromosome. HPH disease is when 3 genes have been deleted. Bart's hydrops fetalis is when all the 4 genes are deleted. So all the 4 alpha genes are absent, you call it Bart's hydrops fetalis. Now alpha thalassemia major, we also call this as hydrops fetalis, that is Bart's hydrops fetalis. The fetus dies only after birth, because till birth there are other chains like zeta which are taking care of the oxygen transport. There may be formation of hemoglobin bars or the tetramer of gamma chains. Because there is no alpha chain, the gamma chains are predominant. All the gamma chains will combine together and form hemoglobin bars. HbH is a tetramer of beta chains. Now it can be either Hb bars or HbH which can be formed. Now the other thalassemia is beta thalassemia. In beta thalassemia, there is decreased production of beta chains. Now again genetics, remember, beta chains are coded on chromosome 11. So when it is chromosome from 11, you have got 2 genes from both the one from each parent. Beta 0 indicates no synthesis of beta chain. Beta plus indicates some amount of synthesis. With this, we can go to the classification. I just tell you a bit about it. Normal is beta beta, 2 chains. Both the chains are normal. If it is a minor trait, one of the chains has decreased production, either no production or decreased production. Intermediate is both, in both the genes there is a defect. Either one is no gene, no production, or some production from only one gene. Major is when both the genes are absolutely not producing the beta gene, or both the genes are producing very less amount of beta globins. Now, beta thalassemia major, that is what is called as. This is also normal at birth because fetal hemoglobin does not have beta chains. Severe cases present with hypochromic microcytic anemia, poikilocytosis, RBC counts higher than expected for the level of anemia, nucleated RBCs may be present. The unaffected chain continues at normal strain, they aggregate and form inclusion bodies. More about this or the clinical feature will be dealt in pathology. Thus, death usually occurs in the first or the second decade of life. That completes the molecular basis for all sickle cell anemia and thalassemia. Thank you.